Well, hi everyone, thank you so much for coming. For those who aren't familiar with the R-Street Institute, we're a center-right think tank. I'm part of the technology shop, and my name is Sasha Moss. My focus area is intellectual property, open data, good governance issues, and digital free speech. Now, I want to thank you guys for coming today. The topic of our panel is the erosion of ownership of the digital age, what it means. And I would say this panel is interesting because we all are connected to it in a certain way. I don't know about you, but I have my cell phone right here. My computer's in front of me. If anyone owns a Kindle, I encourage you to take out your bag and raise it up at certain points when we talk about the Kindle. Because this is what the panel is essentially going to cover. It's how copyright basically affects all of our lives in ways that we don't necessarily know, understand, or can see unintended or intended consequences of the 76 Act of Britain. As a quick disclaimer, because copyright is such a complex topic, and we have a fantastic group of audience members today from different fields, but all technically oriented with the content tech community. If my panelists go too far in the weeds and start rattling off statute or case law, I'm going to ask them to de-legalize it and explain it to, say, no offense, anyone here, like a five-year-old, how you'd explain it to somebody.
No offense,
who isn't oriented in the topic, because I think that's where copyright sometimes we get lost in the conversation. It's very highfalutin chat. And we need to make it base level so we can find really easy solutions to these complex problems we see every day. And that's what we strive to do at our street. So a little bit about that, I'd like to introduce our first panelist, Jason Schultz, and you'll be able to learn 3 minutes time to give some of your background, your interest in the topic, and how you ended up here. Okay. Jason.
Thanks, Sasha. Well, thank you all for coming. So part of the reason, if it isn't obvious already, that Aaron and I are here is that we wrote a book called The End of Ownership, Personal Property in the Digital Economy. And part of our interest in writing this was because of the transformation I think that we all have seen around these questions of ownership, and it hasn't always been clear what's been going on, that there's this sort of sense, though, I think that as the more your purchases become digital, you know, anywhere from movies and music and books to now any kind of device that's network connected, your thermostat, your car, your Barbie doll, whatever it is, that there's something going on here, and really trying to figure out what that is, and then what are the kind of pros and cons of that, and what are the options, and should we be just kind of keeping going down this road, or should we be thinking about other things that we might want to address to make sure that the benefits are maximized, but that we don't suffer any unforeseen, you know, unintended consequences that could be severe. And so in writing the book, we kind of tried to isolate some of the functions that ownership has traditionally done, especially when you have copyright law involved, right? So you have something like a movie or, you know, a book or something, but even now anything that has software in it, because of course software is subject to copyright law, and the kind of tension between the intellectual property rights of the creator or the rights holder and then the personal property rights of you as the owner of the device, if this mug were, you know, software enabled.
Thanks for our product placement.
Right, I was going to say, it's not though. Where's the chip? Right. So, as an example to think about e-books, right, and some of the issues that come up around traditional roles of books, and we'll probably talk more about this, but, you know, the role of archives and libraries and people who own books, whether intentional or not, is often preservation, right? You're keeping these things, and if you're not keeping them, yeah, sometimes you throw them away, but mostly you might give them away or sell them at a used bookstore or donate them to a library or a school or something else. You know, often, you know, if you're traveling, there'll be a little library of people who, like, finished a book while they're traveling, and they leave it there, right? So there's this sort of way in which the sort of ability to own something is also the ability to get rid of it. And how you get rid of it, whether you resell it or, you know, give it to someone or donate it, leave it to your kids, whatever you do, is sort of one of those things that we talk about in the book. And we talk about that's just something that we've always assumed happens. But what happens when it's on the Kindle app, on your phone? Right? Is it like, well, I guess, you know, maybe I can, you know, reassign my account at some point, but what if I'm, you know, in a horrible accident, or what if I lose my phone, or how does this all work? And, you know, these things are kind of getting worked out, but they're not as clear and simple and clean as it used to be when you just owned it. And that was it. It was part of your estate, and they inherited everything. They went to your house, and they took it, or you sold it, or you, you know, whatever happened there. And so that's one of the key issues there. Another thing we look at is competition and innovation. Right, so you say, oh, well, what does that have to do with it? Well, a lot of the digital marketplaces kind of have come about by an assumption that we have the right to move things around, right? So eBay, right? It's like, I have something, I want to sell it. Someone wants to buy it, right? It's a whole marketplace. But even like more electronic oriented marketplaces like YouTube, where if I upload something and someone wants to watch it, right? But there are a lot of places in the digital economy which are looking to kind of pair people, right? Peer-to-peer matching in some way. And to the extent that we own something and then we can transfer it to someone else, that is a marketplace that enables that transaction to happen. To the extent that there are complications with that process, then it's much less likely that a platform will emerge that's robust and scalable and easy. And then also, like, what are the kind of innovation possibilities, right? So, for instance, if you buy a book or some other device or some other thing, let's say you buy, a software-embedded toy, and you start tinkering around with it, and you're like, oh, wow, I can make this toy do something different. It can flip backwards, or it can like work with this other toy, or these three toys are now talking and dancing together. Well, copyright law might have a lot to say about that, too. And if it was just that you owned the toy, well, then there might not be a problem. But to the extent that you are licensed and that the toy and the intellectual property and the software is still controlled and owned by a copyright owner who has not given you permission, we get into a lot of complicated areas and issues that involve innovation and what you can actually do with the things you own if you have ideas about what you want to do with them. So I'll stop there. Lots to talk about. Excited to be here.
Thank you. My name is Todd Dupler. I'm with the Recording Academy. The Recording Academy is the organization best known for the Grammy Awards, but we're a membership association. We represent 24,000 music creators, artists, songwriters, and studio professionals. So most of my comments are going to be somewhat narrowly focused on the music sector. And when I think about this question, erosion of ownership, it seems like, at least in the music space, it would have been a much more interesting conversation maybe 5 years ago. If I was commenting on it then, I might have used the thinking emoji. Today, I would use a shruggy emoji. And to kind of illustrate, in 2005, which wasn't that long ago, revenue for the recorded music industry, 91% came from physical sales, 7.5% came from downloads, and about 2% came from streaming. In 2010, it was then 54% physical sales, about 40% downloads, and 7% streaming. Then fast forward 2015, just last year, it's 30% physical, 35% downloads, 35% streaming. And then this year, at least half year, for the first half of 2016, streaming now accounts for 47% of all revenue from the recorded music business, 31% for downloads, and just a slim 20% for physical. And so we see a clear movement in the marketplace where the consumer isn't really interested in ownership. They're interested in access. And we see this in the music space, but we also see it in other sectors of the economy. Obviously, video with Netflix and Hulu and Amazon, but also transportation with Uber or Lyft or a Zipcar or a bike share or Airbnb. What we see in the marketplace is that consumers are less interested in personal ownership and they're more interested in access. So that's what we're giving them. We're meeting the demand and the expectation of the consumer and providing what they want. But there is an area where we have seen an erosion of ownership, and it isn't for the consumer, it's for the creator of the copyright. That as we've moved into these new digital business models, it's the property right of the person that creates the copyrighted work that's seeing their ownership interest compromised, especially in the music space. If you are a songwriter or an artist, you are subject to compulsory licensing, to government rate setting that are set at rates below a fair market value in the marketplace. You're regulated by different agencies. Songwriters in particular have been fighting a long-running dispute with the Department of Justice over regulations that are onerous and affecting them, and again, suppress the value of their work beneath free market. And so if we're talking about here at R Street, the free market and ideas for the free market, if there's a rebalancing that needs to take place in copyright law, it is to give the creators of copyright more control over their work in the free market so that they can get fair value for the work that they create.
Thank you. I'm Jonathan Band. I represent both library associations and a group called the Owners' Rights Initiative. And both of those groups have a very, you know, close interest to this issue of ownership. Now, even though later on, you know, we'll get, yeah, actually the rest of the panel is going to be talking about this in the digital context, I started my involvement in this issue really in the physical context, and I think it's important to just dwell on that a little bit as a starting point. So as Jason indicated, you know, you have the physical copy, and then you have the copyright of the work that's embodied by the physical copy. So again, if you imagine you have a book, you own the book, but the author owns the copyright in the book. And then the question is like, well, what rights do you, as the owner of the book, as opposed to the author, have? And so one of the basic notions that's been around, you know, it's really based on English common law, but then it's been, you know, it was codified more recently in the first sale doctrine, is this notion of, again, the first sale doctrine, where the distribution right that belongs to the copyright owner is exhausted after the first sale of the book, so that when you buy the book, a legitimately made book, once you buy the book, you own that copy and you are allowed to resell it, you're allowed to give it away, you're allowed to throw it away. You own that copy. You can't make further reproductions of that unless you fall under some other exception. But the basic notion is that you own that copy and you're able to resell it without worrying about infringing the author's distribution right, because that distribution right with respect to that copy is over after the first sale. Now, that issue has become complicated when, what happens if you bought the copy overseas? Were you still allowed to import the copy? So you sort of had this interaction between international trade policy and sort of domestic copyright policy. And you know, that was actually a big issue that went back and forth in the courts. Ultimately, the Supreme Court a few years ago, in the Kurtzing decision, decided that that we had an international exhaustion that policy, that was the proper notion, the proper way to interpret the Copyright Act. In other words, as long as it was lawfully made, then you are allowed to import it and resell it in the United States. So a lot of times, copyright owners want to segment markets and prevent these parallel imports. But we thought, and again, this was the Owners' Rights Initiative, and then that the library groups thought it was very important to be able to import works. Again, as we're talking about lawfully made copies, if you can buy them overseas somewhere at a lower price, you should be able to import them and sell them in the United States. And Justice Breyer, in his opinion, really went on and on about how important, you know, this is, you know, the first sale doctrine really is sort of this very basic notion embedded in English common law and the common law of property, that you own the copy and you should be able to do with it as you please, you know, if importing it is one of the things, you know, you should be able to do that. Just very quickly, there's two other areas that policy areas where there have been efforts to restrict the ability to use physical copies to alienate your rights in your property rights, and these are what we see in Europe. There's one is the public lending right, under which if a library owns a copy, you have to, every time the library lends the copy, it needs to pay an additional fee to the copyright holder. And so this is originally a concept that was in the Scandinavian countries, but now it's spread throughout Europe. There's a European directive so that every time you have to lend the copy. So even though the library owns the copy, there's still this, you know, ongoing tax that libraries have to pay. The second area is the resale royalty. That applies to works of visual art, let's say a painting. Even if you own the painting, In Europe, every time you, you know, if you resell the painting, of your, if it's sold by an art gallery, the gallery has to pay basically a fee to the copyright owner. And so you have to sort of pay, and every time that painting is sold, another fee is paid to the copyright owner. Some states in the United States have that as a matter of state law. California, for example, has it. There have been efforts at the federal level to make that in part of the Copyright Act. But you know, again, we sort of see that as a bit of a, as a tax on your ownership. I mean, if you own the copy, you should be able to sell the copy without having to pay. You have to pay sales tax, of course, but you don't. You know, but that goes to the government. You shouldn't have to pay. You should be able to freely alienate your property without having to pay an additional royalty to the rights holder. Thanks.
So my name is Aaron Perzanowski. I teach law at Case Western Reserve University. So, you know, Jason and I, as he mentioned, you know, we've been working and thinking about and writing about these sets of issues for the better part of a decade now. And it's kind of culminated in this book, The End of Ownership, that we recently published. But you know, the question that we've been circling in all of this work is, you know, what does it mean for an individual to own something in the digital economy? And for a long time now, IP rights holders have been really effective at leveraging the rhetoric of property rights, right? That's been an incredibly effective tool for them. But I think there's been a failure to recognize that there's a competing set of property rights at stake in all of these policy conversations, namely the personal property rights of consumers. So there's a long history here of this sort of hostility towards personal property rights. Going back to the first time the Supreme Court ever thought about copyright exhaustion or the first sale doctrine, the Bobbs Merrill case, we saw the publishing industry trying to impose restrictions on downstream prices, trying to tell people who bought books how much they were allowed to sell them for going forward. When we saw the introduction of home video, right? Hollywood was really eager to crack down on the rental market. When CDs were introduced, we saw record labels targeting record shops that sold used CDs. If you look at the gaming industry today, there are a lot of efforts to crack down on the GameStops of the world and other used retailers. Now, this is a long history. It goes back over a century of trying ineffectively, for the most part, to restrict and eliminate these kinds of personal property rights. But there's been, over the last, you know, couple of decades, a cluster of kind of interrelated developments that I think have kind of conspired against consumer personal property rights going forward. Jason is sort of the optimist in our team. I'm here to paint the picture of future dystopia. So that's what I'm gonna do for the next couple minutes here. So why is this happening? First, the things that consumers have grown accustomed to owning, copies, are disappearing from the marketplace, right? They're becoming much less important, right? You talk about the shift to streaming. Lots of pro-consumer benefits of streaming, right? But we've got to think about the potential downsides of that shift as well. And what we're trying to do for the most part here is just get people to think about what these trade-offs look like, right? So the copy disappears, the thing that we have traditionally thought of as the consumer's property interest has gone away. Second, we see restrictive end user license agreements that are really aggressive in trying to characterize transactions that we would normally think of as sales, a one-time payment in exchange for perpetual possession, as something other than a sale, right? As a license, something that does not transfer title. Third, we see DRM and more broadly control over embedded software that means for even the physical devices that we buy and think that we own, manufacturers can assert ongoing control over how you use and sometimes even whether you can use the products that you buy. And finally, digital retailers are using marketing language that I think it's fair to describe as deceptive, language like the buy now button, to kind of take advantage of consumer expectations of ownership that come from the physical world, to kind of lull them into this sense that those same kinds of rights apply in the digital context, to use, to transfer, and sometimes even to keep the goods that they buy, right? So these are the factors that I think are leading to this erosion of ownership. And these are not concerns that are sort of abstract or theoretical. Our book is in large part a catalog of examples of bad things happening to consumers over the past 10 years with respect to this loss of ownership, right? So we're getting these sort of frequently, these sort of increasingly frequent glimpses into a future without personal property rights. We see it when companies like Autodesk use their license terms to restrict and prevent the transfer of lawfully made and lawfully acquired physical copies of a work. As we'll talk about in a couple minutes, we see it when Amazon remotely deletes Kindle books, including, seriously, 1984, from the devices of consumers who bought those books. We see it when Keurig coffee makers, in like open mutiny against their owners, use optical scanning technology to refuse to brew off-brand coffee pods. Your coffee maker is literally like, stop being cheap, go back to the store and buy the coffee we told you to buy. Do you own a coffee maker that doesn't listen to your instructions, right? We see it when companies like Lexmark use patent law to prevent consumers from refilling their ink cartridges in their printers. We see it when John Deere insists that the software embedded in their tractors, those copies of software, do not belong to the farmers who spend tens of thousands of dollars on these tractors. And instead, the farmers have a license to drive the tractor for the device's lifetime. We see it when Google-owned Nest decides to brick thousands of Revolve home automation hubs simply because it can't be bothered to support this device anymore, right? Just doesn't work. They turn the thing off in your home. We see it, as Jason and I recently wrote about, when Tesla tells you, hey, if you buy one of our $75,000 robot cars, don't try to use Lyft or Uber, right? You're prohibited from doing that with the car that you purchased, right? So this is the direction that we're going in. And it very well may be, right, that consumers prefer models that are not premised on ownership, that are premised on temporary access, that are premised on subscription, that are premised on some sort of, as much as I hate the label, kind of sharing economy model. We're not saying that's a bad choice to make. We're saying it's a choice with consequences, and we need to think through what those consequences are. So I'll stop there.
That was incredibly depressing, Aaron.
That's the goal.
I'll cheer you up a little bit. Sure, no problem. Thanks, Sasha. Thanks for having me. Thanks to R Street. My name is Steve Tepp. I am the president and CEO of my own consulting firm, Sentinel Worldwide, where I work on IP issues both in the United States and internationally in support of clients who have vested interests in protecting and enforcing intellectual property rights. Before that, I was at the Chamber of Commerce, the Copyright Office, and I got my start in IP with Senator Orrin Hatch on his Judiciary Committee staff. As I looked at the panel, it occurred to me I'm glad that I got added because I think it's important to bring a conservative voice to the table because I think there's some pretty conservative, pretty important conservative issues at stake here, including free markets, right here on the R Street card. to the extent that you're hearing examples about what Google and Amazon and Tesla are doing, those are fascinating and maybe a little concerning and raise all sorts of issues about privacy and participation in daily life in the marketplace. But the panel was framed about copyright. Those things didn't seem necessarily to have anything to do with copyright. So I want to focus in on the copyright aspects, because these issues are actually not new. Organizations like EFF, I think Jason has some affiliation with them in the past, have been asking for changes to copyright law for over 15 years. And the change they're asking for is to prohibit certain business models in the marketplace. That's what this is really about, outlawing business models. Can a business offer a consumer the choice of a download that's permanent, a download that's limited, times out after a week or a month, or just access or access for a limited period of time with different tiered pricing, so that a consumer can make a choice about how much they want to pay and how much functionality they get? If the change that has been proposed in the past is enacted, that's the federal government saying, no. No, consumers, you don't know what's good for you, and we, the government, are going to come in and paternalistically tell you what type of licenses will and won't be permitted, what will and won't be enforceable. As usual, when government tries to dictate the market, I think that results in reducing consumer choice, increasing prices, because, of course, if all the companies can offer is the most highest level of functionality, well, they're going to charge the highest price. And those artificial restrictions mean that you're suppressing demand, because on the supply-demand curve, you're artificially increasing price. Even the Obama administration concluded in a white paper that came out that this notion of amending copyright law to require these types of business models aren't justified, and that an expanded first sale doctrine, as Jonathan was talking about, could curtail at least some of the flexibilities of new business models. Because licensing, as Todd mentioned, businesses are responding to what consumers want and offering licenses that address it. It also seems to me this is really an argument more about the past than the future at this point. As the statistics Todd mentioned bear out, consumers want access, not ownership. And that's logical. I mean, ownership means you've got to pay for storage, and if you want to use it or have access to it, you've got to carry something around with you that contains whatever it is you're storing. Given how widespread bandwidth, high-speed bandwidth and Wi-Fi connections are these days in this country, I think it's logical for consumers to say, no, I'd rather have the lower-cost access. Jonathan mentioned the resale royalty. I'll just delve into that for a moment to say that there are, I think at this point, over 70 countries around the world that have a resale royalty, but it's extremely limited. It does not apply to the copyright owner. It only applies to the original artist. Most laws affect only fine art, which has been reproduced less than 200 times. The bill pending in the U.S. Congress has that restriction as well, and would only apply at sales at one of the established auction houses, like Christie's or Sotheby's, not private sales between individuals. And the royalty is only 5%. So you're talking about fine artists who literally sell a painting of which they may have only made 20 or 25 copies each by hand. They sell it for, I don't know, $500, and then 20 years later someone resells it for tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands. A percentage of that going back to the artist that's less than the percentage the auction house charges doesn't seem that unreasonable to me. There's one more piece of this that you're not being told. It's being framed as all about consumers, and there is a consumer. But this is also, to the extent we're talking about amending the copyright law to expand the first sale doctrine,
in service of very large commercial interests. When you combine the proposal for an expanded first sale doctrine with recent case law about mass digitization of copyrighted works that permits that to be done without permission or compensation to the copyright owner, what you have are tens of millions of copies of copyrighted works being digitized. Those are, according to the case law, lawfully made copies, which is now the test. For Jonathan mentioned the first sale doctrine. We call it that, but it actually hasn't revolved on whether there's been a first sale in 40 years because Congress codified it without any reference to that. It's whether the copy was lawfully made, and those are lawfully made copies. So then you change the law that says, well, if you've got a digital copy, even though the first sale doctrine's always been about limiting the distribution right, we're going to let you do what we call forward and delete. You can send it to somebody and promise you delete it. Maybe there's some technology that tries to enforce that, and maybe it works, maybe it doesn't. And we're going to call that close enough. Well, now you've got tens of millions of copyrighted works digitized without permission or payment, and then those are lawfully made and they can be transferred. And we're already seeing a step in that direction. Just yesterday, the Librarian of Congress announced a partnership with the Digital Public Library of America to start digitizing the Library of Congress collections. So when you wrap that all together, you see very little left of effective copyright law. There's a lot more, but I'll stop there so we can get into some of the exchanges.
Well, thank you again for joining us. I think we're going to start off with a really great quote I found in The Consumerist from an article in 2015. Kate Cox compared software to a rock concert. You get to watch and participate and enjoy it, but you don't own the musician, the concert, or any recordings made of it. You pay for the time, liberal experience of using it, or of being there, I should say. Kind of couching within, as Aaron pointed out, the example of Amazon. If anyone, again, if you have a Kindle, raise it up every time we say Kindle. Kind of a fun trip we have going on today. Of deleting the book 1984. So I'm going to go back to Aaron. Can you quickly describe what had happened and why that, I guess, got the competition going on license as the loanership versus ownership dichotomy?
Yeah, so this happened back in 2009. Amazon was in a dispute with a publisher about who exactly had the rights to sell certain books. And decided, I think quite appropriately, to pull those titles from the Kindle store until they could figure out if the actual copyright holder was the one selling the books and being compensated for the books. That seems like a pretty reasonable move. The thing they did that did not seem particularly reasonable to me was that they decided as well to remotely delete all of the purchased copies of these books from the devices of consumers who had already paid for them, right? So they go to sleep one night owning a copy of 1984. They wake up the next morning and that copy has gone down the memory hole, right? The copy is no more, right? That to me is problematic, right? It's problematic because it is inconsistent with the reasonable expectations of consumers in terms of what it means to buy something. Your local bookseller, right, can't come into your house in the middle of the night and take your books away and leave a check on the bookshelf saying, hey, sorry, we sold you this, we shouldn't have, here's a refund, right? That's not how things work in the analog world. And I think it was a surprise to consumers that those kinds of powers were vested in retailers in the digital world, right? That is not to say that, you know, retailers like Amazon don't enjoy and shouldn't enjoy a considerable degree of flexibility in how they package and market digital products to consumers. But there have to be some constraints on those choices, right? Now, and maybe you think constraints are inherently inconsistent with the idea of a free market. I have an uncomfortable truth for everyone in this room. When it comes to IP goods, when it comes to information goods protected by IP rights, there is no free market. It's intervention all the way down, right? A free market is the free appropriability of public goods. It's no copyright protection whatsoever. I don't want to go down that path. I don't think very many people in this room want to go down that path. So the set of questions that we need to be asking are, what are the right kinds of restrictions? What are the right kinds of regulations? It's not none, right? It's a matter of finding the sort of appropriate balance between the rights of consumers and the rights of IP owners, right? One of those constraints, I think, has to be making accurate information available in the marketplace. You can't go around calling something a sale when you reserve the right to delete the product that you sold to the consumer. You can't go around calling something a sale when you're not allowed to resell it, when you're not allowed to give it away as a gift, when you're not allowed to leave it in your will. These are pretty common sense sorts of restrictions on free market behavior. And I think, you know, the conversation we have to have is not whether there are restrictions or limitations, but what the right set of restrictions is going to look like.
Todd, please.
So going back to the Amazon case, there's a couple of things that stood out to me. The first is that it was 2009, so it's almost 8 years ago now, and I think you know, the immediate response from Amazon is that they realized that they made a mistake and that they weren't going to do it again. And as far as I'm aware, in the ensuing 8 years, I don't think it has happened again. You know, I think it's has a lot of great notoriety because it did happen to be 1984. As you know, as Jay Peterman would say, that's perfect irony, Elaine. But I think, you know, the other thing, the core issue that started it was that you had a publisher who was trying to sell a work that they did not have the rights to, right? I mean, that's what caused the problem, is that you had a publisher trying to sell something that they shouldn't have been selling. And again, eroding the interests of the publisher that did have the rights to those books. This is an issue that does still come up in this marketplace, right? So we learned just last month that Amazon stocks a whole lot of counterfeit CDs in their warehouses that are indistinguishable from the authentic real CDs. They're getting into their supply chain through China somehow, and when they stock them in the warehouse, they all look the same, so they all get put together. And again, Amazon has responded appropriately and is trying to track down on this, but to me, that's the root of the problem in this situation, rather than this more downstream issue.
Yep, but I think that's actually the perfect example, right? Because Amazon pulling from its own warehouse, its own property, is fine, but I mean, the difference to me is, should Amazon then go to every single person who had already bought the CD and has it in their home and be able to sort of extract it out of your home, even if it's counterfeit, right? Because copyright law has not traditionally allowed that. Like, even if it's counterfeit, yeah, well, once it's bought, I mean, so the whole idea is, yeah, you cut it off at the supply chain, you know, before it's sold. And I think that's the difference. I mean, the 1984 Kindle example, it's not that it was at one moment in time, but it's representative. I mean, the Revolve example that Aaron mentioned, and I think that we see this now in a lot of different places around kind of the IoT, Internet of Things kind of world, where there are going to be ongoing situations where the thing you bought ends up being controlled even after you bring it to your home. And the question is, I mean, I think there's two questions. One is, what are the right ways to characterize that? Like, it may be that consumers want it, but it also may be that consumers don't know and they're just accessing it or buying it or doing these other things. And I think that's one of the things we want to do, is generate more of a conversation about what is the honest, you know, market, the honest free market look like, right?
Speaking of the free market, Stephen, yeah. I think you might be able to jump in here.
Yeah, well, certainly to the extent we're talking about issues of consumer information, no question, consumers should have accurate information about what it is they are or aren't purchasing. It's inevitable on this panel we're going to end up talking about the length of the license agreements, in some cases called EULAs, End User License Agreement. That's one example, but you know, by the same token, when you sign up for, you know, your email service, when you sign up for your telecom service, when you sign up for eBay, whatever, not to single out anybody, they all have terms of service much longer than anybody reads. And I'm just as concerned about a retailer remotely deleting things from people's computers as I am about search engines changing their privacy policy so they now track personally identifiable information. identifiable information. And there's no question, over the years, you can find examples where copyright owners have done things that don't seem very consumer-friendly. As an overarching message and as a free marketeer, my initial reaction is, before we have the government jump in, let's see if the market resolved that. Because my guess is, if any company keeps doing that, people are going to start migrating away from that company. Now, the one other thing I want to come back to was I almost fell off my chair. The free market equals no copyright? Holy mackerel. Okay. So you talked about the long-running, some of the long history of copyright ownership. It goes back even further. It goes back to James Madison writing the Copyright and Patent Clause into our Constitution, in which he specifically wrote about providing authors and inventors with exclusive rights, the right to exclude. That's a property right. Limited by time and other things? Absolutely, and appropriately so. But when we look at how easy it is to make illicit copies of particularly copyrighted works by someone who has invested no talent, no time, and no money in the creation of those works, this is classic unfair competition. This is a distortion of the marketplace. That's what the founders understood when they wrote the Copyright and Patent Clause. That's what George Washington understood when he urged Congress in the first State of the Union address to enact a copyright law. And that's what the first Congress understood in 1790 when it enacted the first copyright law. And it's evolved as technology has developed, both in terms of what media can be the source of creative works, as well as how they can be copied and distributed. And that's all good. That's part of history, and that's the way we work. But to say no copyright and allow unfair competition at will is a free market, I'm sorry, that's just wrong.
I'm gonna allow Aaron a quick 2 minutes to jump back in.
So I think we agree in the broad strokes about what the right policy is. Copyright law should exist. It's important, right? And it serves real values. My point is just that in the absence of legislation, in the absence of some form of intervention, of some form of regulation, we don't have that protection. There is no common law copyright. Copyright is statutory. It's not about unfair competition. It's about the Act of 1790 through the Act of 1976. And that is government intervention to regulate the market. And it's an appropriate regulation. I think there are other appropriate regulations. That's the only point I'm making.
I don't regard property rights as regulation any more than I regard state protection of real property to be regulation.
Jonathan?
Yeah, well, this is a discussion that will go nowhere because, you know, it ends up being, it's all about trying to frame it in a way that, you know, if by calling it a property right, and if you like property, then you should have more protection and so forth. But that really doesn't help us move this discussion forward to really understand at a better rate what's really going on. So I think it's very important to distinguish two things. We've been talking about sort of pure digital goods. So that would be like the stream or the download, right? Where it's purely digital, or even like the 1984 on a Kindle. That's one kind of activity. That's one set of, and that poses a certain set of issues, and you know, questions about consumer expectations and what's the right balance and so forth. That's different from the issue of devices that have software embedded in it and that is essential to its operation. I'm not saying that one is a more interesting set of issues than the other. They're both very interesting, but it's really important to keep them separate, because during the conversation today, you know, we've been sort of sliding from one to the other, but it seems to me that certainly in terms of the consumer expectation issue, as time has evolved, you know, certainly if I'm streaming music, I understand that I'm just streaming it, that I don't own it. When I click something, buy it now, I tend to think that I'm buying it, but, you know, okay, maybe, yes, there's these, you know, endless terms of service, but that's somewhat a different issue. But no matter what, I think we're all used to the fact that, at least to some extent, when you're dealing with purely digital products, that your ownership rights are somewhat limited, even if you think you own it. And again, we can talk about what are the you know, appropriate limitations of what are the appropriate bounds on what you should, as a consumer, end up with. On the other hand, when you have a physical object, you know, the John Deere tractor or the Tesla, what you spend $75,000 for, and then they're saying, well, you own the tractor, but you are only, you know, sort of licensing the software in the tractor or licensing the software in the Tesla that you that already comes installed. You don't even have to download it, right? I mean, you know, it's already there when you bought it. And then to sort of have all kinds of restrictions on you know, being able to use the Tesla in certain ways, being able to do certain things with your tractor, that seems to me to be much more problematic, and, you know, really running much more flying in the face of consumer expectations, but also good public policy, because then it allows, it gives the copyright owner all kinds of downstream control that, I don't think the James Madison ever intended.
There are also a couple of other issues. I mean, like, so there's the one framing of the question of, like, a business model and transactions, and I think we talked about that, but there are also these externalities, right? From the sort of law and economics point of view, I think we have to look at what are the impacts on our economy and on technology and on other issues. I mentioned the competition innovation things. There's actually, I mean, any of you who've been following the conversation around security and cybersecurity and the Internet of Things botnets, right? The ones that people have been very, very concerned with and that are only likely to get worse. One of the major issues in that is that a lot of people are manufacturing devices that are essentially insecure or soon to be insecure the minute you own them, and then need to be secured and or updated. Well, if you buy your thermostat but you don't own it, that raises these questions. What if you want to update it? Well, you are potentially violating a regulation that was lobbied for, which is Section 1201 of the Copyright Act, which restricts...
Can you quickly explain Section 1201 to our audience?
Okay. So when anyone puts on a technological protection measure or some form of digital rights management or anything that constrains your ability to go into something that's a copyrighted work, there are questions raised around accessing that work without authorization of the copyright owner. That's what the Section 1201 does. It sort of says you can't access or copy certain copyrighted works without permission. And there are questions raised about that in context of movies and books and things, but also just software in general. There's also the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, which is an anti-hacking law, which has also come up a bunch in the news lately. And so, you know, the question is, we might be fine with this. We might say, well, the market will decide, right? The market will figure this all out. But there's a kind of collective action question of our security overall when we have millions of devices where some manufacturer just bought a chip from China and it's vulnerable and it's in there. And then how do we address that, right? And so I just think it's also important that we not get focused solely on the kind of business-to-consumer question, but also at these broader issues, because these are policy questions that are going to be really important. And these ownership issues of if I own a tractor and it breaks down, I can repair it. If it's dangerous and it might hit some kid, I can hopefully fix that. But in the digital and cybersecurity context, these things get a lot more, get a lot trickier.
I'm getting about something Jonathan said earlier regarding downstream control. I think that's a really interesting concept, what it means to be an owner in digital world. And Jonathan, if you'd like to go more in detail, what you can kind of flesh that concept out more, please.
Right. So I think that there's really two pieces. So one of it is what Jason already alluded to, which is the Section 1201. So if you again imagine the John Deere tractor, it has the software installed, and you want to do a repair or a modification. You know, you want to have it, you know, be able to pull something that it's, you know, that's not a John Deere compatible thing. You want to be able to have it attached to something else. Right now, because of the software, again, so much of these devices, especially, you know, tractors are actually pretty sophisticated these days. So much of it is, so much of the operation of the tractor is controlled by the software. And if it has digital rights technology imposed, inserted in it, then to do all this repair, modification, customization, you need to circumvent the technological protection in order to do whatever it is you want to do. You know, at least in the old days, the farmer was able to sort of pull out his monkey wrench and do whatever he wanted to do. Now, He needs to be more sophisticated, and but a lot of them are sophisticated, or they have people who can help them do this, but they would have to deal with Section 1201 and engage in the circumvention. There is a rulemaking that allows you can go through the process, and a narrow exemption was granted, but it's only lasts for 3 years, and it's relatively narrow and needs to be, and it only applies to certain kinds of vehicles and not other kinds of vehicles, and allows certain activities and other activities. But again, you're talking about a farmer who's bought a $100,000 tractor, and the notion that anytime he wants it repaired, he'd have to go to a John Deere authorized repair place, or that he would only have to buy John Deere authorized attachments, is really problematic from an ownership point of view, it seems, given that he spent $100,000 on this tractor. The second part actually goes back to what I was talking about before with alienability of property and the Kurtzing decision and so forth, and that is, can he sell the tractor without John Deere's permission? John Deere is saying that he doesn't own the copy. If he owned the copy, then the first sale doctrine applies and he'd be able to sell the copy. But if he only is a licensee of the copy, that means he doesn't own the copy, then he can't sell the copy, which means he can't, as a practical matter, can't sell the tractor, right? He could sell the tractor without the software, but the tractor is useless without the software. Now you say, well, that's far-fetched, but actually that's exactly what happens right now with a lot of computer products. So most servers contain operating systems. The operating systems are licensed, they're distributed under a license. And so if you want to sell your server, Cisco will basically say, you have to pay them a license fee in order to, or if you're the new purchaser and you want to be able to repair it or whatever, you need to pay a license fee to Cisco that, in essence, again, they're restricting the ability to transfer or requiring you to pay a tax on transfer. And so this is something that is routinely happens in the tele, with computer products, with servers, a lot of with switches, with even probably the phones that this office uses, they all have software in them, and a lot of times telephone systems, those network telephone systems, also there are restrictions on transfer, and the vendor makes you, pay an added license fee if you want to sell it, or if you're the downstream consumer. So it's both the ability to modify and repair. That's one set of issues, and the other one is simply just the ability to alienate, to sell your product.
I see a lot of nodding heads. I'm going to go online. Todd, Stephen, and Aaron, if you'd like to reply.
So just a quick note on 1201, which isn't really the sandbox that we normally play in, but I will say, the important thing to know about the anti-circumvention provisions in 1201 is that they were put in place originally to give copyright creators some sense of certainty and confidence that they were shielded from some infringement when they went into the digital marketplace and started offering their products in this new environment, that they weren't going to get, completely wiped out by losing the stuff that they created. And it's worked in that regard. 15 years ago, the question was, well, why won't copyright creators put their goods into the digital marketplace? Well, that's not the question anymore, because they've done that. They've put it out there. So we've seen success in part because of these protections from 1201. Having said that, there is a process in place to create exceptions where they are appropriate. And like you said, every 3 years, stakeholders can go to the copyright office. They talk about what exceptions they think are appropriate and why, and the copyright office can create those exceptions for them. And that process is a feature and not a bug, because technology and the marketplace and business models change so rapidly that you have to look at it every 3 years to come up with what's appropriate. If you locked something in and said, hey, this should obviously be an exception, 10 years from now, you could be living in a completely different world, and the thing that you locked into the law 10 years ago doesn't make sense anymore. So I think that triennial review as something that makes a lot of sense and works. I don't think we've seen a lot of market failure in that area.
Stephen, with your work with the Copyright Office, can you elaborate a little further on the triennial process as well?
Sure. When Congress enacted the Digital Millennium Copyright Act in 1998, it had two main pieces. One is Section 1201 that we're talking about. The other dealt with broad swath of immunity for internet platforms in exchange for qualifying by undertaking certain obligations, which was, of course, a demand of the internet companies in order to be willing to not be put up a roadblock to the Section 1201 that was being contemplated. As part of the negotiation process that gave us the law we have now, Congress inserted this three-year rulemaking process, which is undertaken by the Copyright Office and the Librarian of Congress to determine if, okay, this is an anti-hacking statute, as Todd said. If we're going to be asked to put our copyrighted works in digital format on the distribution network of the internet, we need to know that there's at least some guard that all the people who are trying to hack the protections we put on there against piracy have at least some legal consequence for doing that. And Congress agreed. They said, you know what, though? Just to make sure that this doesn't get overused, every 3 years the Copyright Office is going to review, and there'll be a process where people submit evidence, written reply comments, oral testimony, the whole nine yards. And if there is evidence of now or likely in the next 3 years that it will prevent non-infringing uses, the Copyright Office and the library will issue an exemption that allows people to go ahead and circumvent, notwithstanding the general rule. And that's what's happened. And the transitioning to the comments that I wanted to make, as Todd alluded, between that rulemaking process, which resulted in 22 exemptions last year, and courts, by and large, the concerns that are being raised have been addressed. The courts and Copyright Office have not sustained the application of 1201, you know, about, you know, Teslas and Uber, which I'm not even sure is a copyright thing at all. But so I think in many respects, this is a solution in search of a problem. Doesn't go far enough for them? Well, I'm not surprised, but I think it's been addressed reasonably. But let me, we've talked a lot about property rights from a certain perspective. I want to put another wrinkle in there. Just by show of hands, how many of you think that if you have a book, the government should be able to order you to give them a copy of that book? If you say if you write a book, the government should be able to order you to send them a copy of that book. So four or five.
So you're against judicial subpoenas?
So,
goodness.
without a subpoena, without any due process at all, except that we order you to give us a copy of the book. Section 407 of the Copyright Act allows the Library of Congress to do exactly that. And without getting too far into the history of the Copyright Office, the reason the Copyright Office is in the library is the copies that you send to the Copyright Office when you run to register your work get taken by the library to build their collection to the tune of $30 million worth of collection every year. And for someone who doesn't register, the librarian can say, I order you to give me a copy of your book. And not just any copy, the best edition, which means the copy I like for my collection. So if it's like a rare manuscript, you can't just give a photocopy. You've got to give a really valuable item. So much for your property rights. Now let's roll that into what I was talking about in my opening statement about how you marry all these things up. A forward and delete, digital first sale, mass digitization, and the Library of Congress giving its collection to the Digital Public Library of America. The library is, I think, going down a very dangerous path, because if copyright owners are going to be in a situation where just by registering their work with the Copyright Office, that work is taken into the library's collection, that work is then given to the Digital Public Library of America, made available to the world, and those copies can then be transferred or copied and just further distributed, all without any permission from the copyright owner, with any payment to the copyright owner, and without offending the law, people are not going to register their works anymore. We're going to blow up the registration system. And I think really the library needs to be very careful about this. We all want things to be available to the public on reasonable terms. But just wholesale, give it, and then these greater and greater loopholes being blown into copyright law, you know, businesses will react to the curtailment of their rights. And that's not helping the free market.
I think it's a really interesting point. I like to open for questions, but I do want Aaron to respond. I feel like you were seething and you were going to say something.
That's just my face. I'll respond really quickly on a couple points. So the point you made about this registration process and the idea that you could engage in mass digitization, which is considered fair use, which then gets rolled into lawfully made copies, I think that's a real concern. Right, I'm not going to disagree with you on that. I think if we move in the direction of some sort of digital first sale right, we have to be really careful about how we construct it, about what limits are imposed on it. It cannot devolve into a sort of free-for-all where everybody just gets everything for free, right? We have to make sure that we kind of that we honor and that we respect this sort of inherent limitations on the transfer of physical goods, right? I buy one book at a bookstore, that doesn't allow me to go home and make a million copies and give them to my friends, right? That can't be the direction that we go. Just real quick on 1201. 1201 is a great example of how carefully created plans don't go the way anyone expected them to, right? 1201 was initially about protecting the interests of traditional copyright holders and giving them an incentive to put their works in the digital marketplace. What we've seen, at least in some industries, music in particular, is that additional incentive isn't really necessary, right? Go buy digital music today online. There's no DRM on any of it. Who benefited from 1201? It wasn't traditional copyright holders. It was Apple. It was Microsoft. It was technology companies that make platforms and devices so that they can tie you into their business model, right? This has backfired in a fantastically, at a sort of fantastic scale. In terms of the exemption process, I read the proliferation of exemptions a little bit differently, right? There are 22 of them this year. To me, that is a sign that 1201 is fundamentally broken. Here's an example of one of the exemptions that the Copyright Office had to grant to copyright law. You're allowed to repair your car. That is stupid, right? That's just stupid, right? You said earlier, these don't seem like things that involve copyright law, and they shouldn't.
You're allowed to repair your pacemaker. Also
so here, you were accommodating to my comment, I'll be accommodating to yours. If we can find a way to look at 1201 to address things that are about competition completely outside the issue of copyright that doesn't blow up the basic necessity for protecting copyrighted works, because frankly you overstated the case that it's both in music and in movies and in books and lots of other works, the protection against hacking those works remains vitally important to the marketplace functioning. If we can find a way to address the one without blowing up the other, happy to have that conversation.
Yeah. And absolutely. On that note, I owned a 1988 Toyota Celica when I was in high school, and I loved repairing it. It was one of my favorite activities. So, opening the floor to questions. Adam?
Hi. Full disclosure, my name is Adam Eisgraub. I'm with the American Library Association. I've been in my current job with them for about 2.5 years, and 15 years prior to that, I had a 4-year tenure as ALA's lobbyist on copyright issues when all this stuff happened. So, you know the expression that is usually metaphoric, that I was in the room at the time? I was in the room at the time. A couple of things the audience and the policy predictors need to understand. With respect, first, to circumvention. The anti-circumvention provisions of the current copyright law very clearly bar circumvention, even if the purpose of the circumvention is, in fact, for a lawful purpose. So let's deconstruct that. There's a public park. A new law gets passed and a fence goes up around the public park. You have an absolute right to use that public park. No new restrictions on the use of the public park, but it's illegal to go through the fence without permission. That's where the 1201 rulemaking came from, because had the 1201 anti-circumvention provisions been linked to copyright infringement, that it's unlawful to circumvent, for purposes of copyright infringement, with all of the penalties, vast statutory damages that apply to being proven to have infringed copyright, then we would not have needed a triennial rulemaking process. And that process came about because John's predecessor, representing a group of library organizations, and I were in the room at 2 o'clock in the morning when word came down that version B of the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, according to House leadership, was the one that was going to pass, not version A. Version A had a very different 1201. It came from the Commerce Committee. So when you talk about the marketplace, it was actually the Judiciary Committee version. I'm simplifying a little bit, but that's the bottom line, that went through and ultimately became law. And the 1201 triennial rulemaking process was something written on the back, literally, of a napkin at 2 o'clock in the morning to preserve the option, somehow, maybe, if we say that every few years, classes of works might be exempted from this ridiculous restriction on circumvention, even though the purpose of the circumvention is lawful, maybe we can come back to this a little bit later. So the triennial rulemaking process, quite candidly, was a foot in the door, we hoped, to injecting some rationality into what was otherwise a dramatically over-restrictive process, particularly, last point, if you realize that the whole purpose of copyright law has nothing to do, skunk at the garden party, with property. In order to promote progress,
that's right.
Thank you. In order to promote progress in science and useful arts, ..
No, don't finish the dots. Finish the sentence, please.
By all means. Yeah.
No, you know it. The part about exclusive rights.
Exclusive rights, exactly. And those exclusive rights in 1790, Stephen will correct me if I'm wrong, I believe were for 14 years.
You're wrong.
The length was?
It was renewable.
Oh, for another 14
years. Sorry, 14 years renewable. Copyright law now, in the case of an individual, is protection for the life of the author plus 70 years, and I believe it's 95 years if you're a corporate corporate person. Do we really think that the framers, who as their primary purpose in the copyright clause, almost unlike any other, said why they were putting it in there, do we really think that they had in mind a property regime that would last for a century? That's what the public interest demanded?
This is the perspective of the lobbyists who lost.
Correct.
Okay? So Congress decided that as you define it,
it sounds like a very carefully balanced
So let's just go back to, you know, Congress was the arbiter of this. The Commerce Committee had say in it. The Judiciary had say in it. Even the Foreign Relations Committee had say because it was implementing a treaty obligation. And the balance that they came to recognized that if you have an intent aspect as part of an anti-hacking statute, it's going to be impossible to prove. Because the guy who hacks is going to say, oh, but I promise I was only going to make fair use of it. And then how do you prove what was in the person's mind at the time? That Congress recognized that was unrealistic, that it was a loophole that would render the provision ineffective, which perhaps was the goal of certain organizations. Now we're into, all of a sudden, talking about the term of copyright. Well, this is a panel about property rights, so I just want to point out you heard an impassioned defense for the exhaustion of property rights in favor of communal property. Congress has made its decision about what that length of that term should be, after lots of debate.
I hear a lot about Congress doing this and Congress doing that. I thought this was all the free market.
The free market is about preventing unfair competition.
No, the point is it's all...
The free market is about preventing unfair competition. What other property expires?
Well, right, because it's, you know, you can call it property, but it's really not property. But the bigger point, getting back to Steve's conspiracy theories, in terms of this, the
conspiracy
Library of
theories.
The Library of Congress and the Digital Public Library of America, and how we're going to end up with these, you know, this vast distribution network of copyrighted product. I mean, that's not at all what's being contemplated. And
Jonathan, trust Steve, I want him. This to continue. Maybe a later day we can have a drink. Put in the back, please.
He's commercial copyright law. I come to actually answer questions. I'm going to level down a little bit and try to touch upon really, I think, what is the heart of the discussion here, which is, you know, at least at the beginning of the discussion, we were a lot of talk about the concerns about consumers, right? Because we're in this sort of state of flux in terms of what the business models are as they move into physical copies and analog, digital, and sort of what reasonable consumer expectations are and things like that. And Steve, at least, I'm not sure anyone else can sort of at least reference EULAs. And I don't think we ever make EULAs easier to understand because lawyers, there are a lot of lawyers in the room here, aren't going to let that happen. So how do we go about making this a better world? How do we go about sort of educating consumers better? And that's, you know, from the, a lot of this is the online platforms, the Amazon that you mentioned, the Apple, the John Deere. How do they educate the consumer so the consumer can say, wait a minute, I don't want to download this book from Amazon because they can come in the middle of the line and take it from me. I'm going to download this book from somebody else because they won't do it, right? How do we educate consumers to do that? And it's got to be obviously in a simple way. It's not going to be for you.
So I'm happy to answer this. So I have a paper coming out in the University of Pennsylvania Law Review in a couple months. It's discussed in less detail in the book, but the key details are there. So I did this survey of consumers to see what they thought the buy now button meant. One finding was it is deceptive on a number of levels. It leaves consumers with a bunch of misperceptions about what sorts of rights they acquire in these digital transactions. The other thing that's responsive to your point, though, is my co-author Chris Hufnagel and I created a short notice, which is sort of a bullet-pointed list of the things that consumers can and cannot do with these digital goods. I don't want to say that they purchase, but that they acquire. So we tried to take the key points from the EULA, and instead of it being, as is the case for the iTunes EULA, 19,000 words long, it's about 40 words, right? It's like 6 or 8 bullet points that say you can do these four things and you can't do these 4 other things. In our empirical research, consumers, their performance, their understanding of their rights was statistically significantly improved through one interaction with a short notice like that. So we can improve people's understandings of these kinds of transactions if we're interested. I don't know that a lot of the digital retailers, without some external prompting, are particularly interested in informing consumers that they're getting a worse deal than they think they're getting. Right? There's not a lot of incentive to do that right now.
Yeah, I think the other issue is related to that is, you know, is competition, meaning really are how many choices are there? And then relatedly, especially when you're talking about the John Deere tractor, at the time, you know, first of all, I don't know how many different tractor companies are still operating in the United States. I mean, you don't have a lot of competition, but the other thing is that when you're buying your $100,000 tractor, you're not necessarily focusing on, you know, your ability to do X, Y, or Z. I mean, you're trying to get a tractor that's going to, you know, do its basic functions, and you're not really focusing on, well, will I be able to, how easy is it going to be able to sell this tractor in 10 or 15 years? Or that's not going to be foremost in your mind. And so the restrictions, even if they're said, well, you know, even if there were a bullet point, you know, you might not worry about that at that time, because that's, you know, something that's 10 years down the road, and you might say, well, the last John Deere tractor I kept for its, you know, its entire life, but maybe, you know, this tractor you're going to want to sell. So that's why there, especially when you're dealing with the physical goods, it's, you know, you have this competition issue, but also it's like what you're worried about now at the time of sale might be different from the kinds of things that, you know, you might not be aware of, or you might not focus on until 5-10 years down the road.
I think everyone's going to be in favor of accurate consumer information. The only point I want to make is this is not an issue unique in any way to copyright. I mean, you buy a car, you lease a car. Either way, you sign a pack of papers that very few people read any more than read the iTunes license or any other terms of service. I mean, refinance a house. Holy mackerel. You're not even buying anything. Right? You're just getting a new loan. Last time I did it, the loan agent stood over me with an evil eye you would not believe, because I dared read the thing. And she had somewhere else she wanted to be. Now, sucks for her, but most people don't read that stuff. This is an information problem that exists in many different respects, and solutions to that, I think, across the board would be welcome.
Right, but the vast majority of the things you were signing when you were refinancing your house were things related to consumer protection. Meaning they were, you know, people sometimes don't like government regulation, but government regulation is always, almost always about consumer protection. And so it was for your good that you were signing all those things.
So I'm not sure that's entirely true.
One other point, if I can really quickly.
No, wait, it's Ron's question. Are you just scratching your head?
No.
Okay, Aaron.
So really quick, right? The other difference, of course, between the kinds of transactions we're talking about, the John Deere tractor aside, and refinancing your house or buying a car, is that it's reasonable to expect consumers to invest a lot of time and information in figuring out the details of their car lease or their home purchase. When we're talking about the purchase of an ebook for $9.99, those information costs, which can be really significant, outweigh the value of the purchase. That's why we have a different set of rules in property law for real property and personal property. Real property, you can carve it up into whatever idiosyncratic bundle of rights you want with some public policy exceptions, right? You can impose all sorts of downstream restrictions on the use of your property in the future. We don't allow that for personal property. We just don't. There's a limited menu of personal property transactions. This is the numerus clausus principle of property law. The number is closed, right? We do not allow the creation of new idiosyncratic bundles of rights. We don't allow servitudes on chattels precisely for this reason, because it increases information costs in a way that is economically inefficient. And I think it's crucial to keep that in mind, right? That's why we might want to limit, I don't want to say we want to limit the business models that companies can adopt. Consumer choice is good, but too much consumer choice can also be harmful, right? It imposes costs on consumers.
Interestingly, we do allow the subdivision of copyright rights just like real property.
Yeah.
Raza.
Explicitly. Congress did that in 76 explicitly.
So, Raza can go on with public knowledge. One of the interesting things that I've noticed, we talked a bit about consumer choice, but a lot of it comes from the direction of we as the owners want to offer certain choices. A, B, C, and D are the menu options, where we want to educate you as to what the limits of those options are. And I think one of the aspects of a dynamic marketplace is where you have signaling mechanisms in both directions. And so my question is to the whole panel is sort of, is there a lack of signaling mechanisms for consumers to say, well, we want to do E instead of A, B, C, or D. And when the answer is, well, we decided that we don't want to offer that option, and by the way, we decided it's illegal. So stick to A through D, please, even if you actually want E. Even if E is allowed for some sort of monetary change or whatnot. And so I'd love to hear both from Todd and Steve on sort of the owner side, but as well from Aaron and Jason as to sort of what, you know, in your research, you may have learned about consumer norms and expectations as to what they want to pay for. Because I think there are things that people do want to pay for.
I would say, I think in the music space, I don't think streaming is anybody's first choice for a business model. If you're the artist or the songwriter or the label or the publisher that's putting music out there, streaming has not been a great value proposition compared to the older, previous, and still hanging around business models for distributing music, right? But we've been forced to go that direction because that's what the consumer has demanded of us. So I think it kind of lays the opposite of the hypothetical you laid out.
One of the things, so when you laid out the statistics in the beginning, I think that was really great because I understood them. That's why I thought it was great. I was like, okay, physical, like a vinyl record, okay, download, okay, like an iTunes thing, and like streaming, like a Spotify, okay, and I'm not endorsing them. I'm just saying those are examples, and it like popped in my head. And so I do think that it's not just the terms of the deal, but it's also, as Aaron was saying, things like what are the kinds of choices? And this is what I mean. Like, I mean, if we want to give up ownership models, like, and that's just what we're saying. And I think that's true. Like, you know, when I watch streaming films, I don't think I own them, right? I think the kind of context and the contours of the platform and the technology, it all kind of maps. One of the things about the ownership model, and I will say it, I will admit I do this, is sometimes I'll buy things because I'm not sure what I, like, where's it going to go? What am I going to do with it? Am I going to keep it? Am I not going to keep it? Like, I just want to have it. Like, I just want to, like, have a sort of sense of simplicity and certainty with it, right?
Shoes sometimes.
Yeah, exactly, right? Shoes or a watch or whatever, you know, anything like, you know, and then I think, and then if I don't want it, one of the things I might assume is, oh, if I don't want it, well, I'll put it up on eBay or I'll Craigslist it or whatever, StubHub my tickets or these kind of things, right? Like, there are these marketplaces, these secondary marketplaces, which are just, in my mind, as much part of the pre-market as the primary ones, right? Which are like a way to make efficient market transactions where I might invest in something, and then if circumstances change, or my mind changes, or my feelings change, or whatever, I can shift and make an economically efficient choice, right? And so the other thing about this is that, and we mentioned, it's hard to foresee those choices, and so I guess I want to make sure we preserve that ownership option as one of the options, right? And so the conversation about copyright law to me and about choices is making sure that those options are preserved as a possibility. And one of the things about the digital economy is this question of whether first sale, this like option of once I buy something, I can resell it, is actually at all available. I mean, the sort of forward and delete model, I think nobody's actually talking about that anymore. I think they're talking about much more sophisticated models, but I'm open to any model, right? I mean, I'm like, can you ever buy digital music and ever resell it under any model? Does innovation and competition for that secondary marketplace even exist? And if it doesn't, if it's completely dead, scorched earth, let's just call it that, but then let's accept that reality that there's no secondary market. Zero.
And you may also be pleased to know there is a small vinyl resurgence, right?
Yeah. Oh, I'm all that
one. Yeah. I'm huge fan, right?
Can I add just like a little bit of data to answer your question?
Not just water.
So we actually tested this question a bit. We asked consumers whether they value certain rights in digital goods, in digital music, movies, and books, things like resale, things like being able to give something away, for example. And consumers do have a preference for digital goods that come with those rights. They are willing to pay more for them, more than the current asking price on Amazon and Apple. And the absence of those rights, we found, steers people in other directions. It steers people towards streaming, and it steers people towards BitTorrent, right? So this is a lost opportunity, right? It's a lost opportunity to charge more money to consumers for giving them a better value proposition. And it's also a lost opportunity to steer them away from business models. I'm reluctant to call BitTorrent a business model.
It is. It very much is. No doubt about it.
Yeah. Well, no, that's fair. But to steer them away from non-preferred means of acquisition, right? If we don't want people to be streaming and we want people to be buying, and you hear this argument a lot, right? I'm not sure about labels. Artists certainly think they do better under a sales model than they do under a streaming model. And certainly no one is happy to see consumers going to BitTorrent and getting things without paying for them. So I think part of the answer is actually get the signal from consumers and give them what they're asking for, which is a more robust set of rights.
And just very quickly, I know we're late on time.
Okay.
I don't want streaming for consumers. I don't want downloads for consumers. Mm-hmm. I want what consumers want for consumers. And I assume that if more money is available to be made through another option, businesses will figure that out and pursue the profit-maximizing route. That's the basis of capitalism. So, you know, fair question, is there an information flow problem so that companies can't find those out? Well, I find that hard to believe when, like, people I follow on Twitter are tweeting at the airline that's keeping them at the gate too long, complaining about that, and the airline responds while they're still at the gate. I think we, in this age, we have a flow of information that's fairly adequate. I mean, that even better than when Henry Ford said, supposedly, you know, they can have the Model T in any color they want so long as it's black, that opened the door to other competitors eventually. So one way or the other, companies will either adjust their practices or other competitors will arise. There is, of course, the persistent problem of unfair competition through theft that really, if we're not talking about that when we're talking about property rights in the digital age, we've missed a huge part of the conversation. And we really haven't talked about it much, but I'll just leave that out.
On that note, the format was going to be ending with a 5 to 7 minute closing statement by each panelist to discard whatever. Because I've already got a 15 minutes, my operations staff will have my neck for it. I have the room till 2. Leave it to the audience. Would you like to have more questions, or would you like to have each panelist recap in a 3 minute spiel? I'm looking at which questions or panelists. Panelists? Okay. So let's begin. Jason took a start.
Yeah, sure. Listen, I mean, I think this has actually been a nice encapsulation of a lot of the issues. And I think what I would say is that, you know, this is actually a very present conversation in a lot of different areas. We've had it primarily in the music, movie, and book area kind of evolving. But it will be ongoing, and especially as every single device we ever purchase going forward is going to have more and more software from more and more copyright owners. And the questions are, I think, fundamentally about, you know, what do we want any ownership interest to look like, or do we just want to kind of let it all evolve? And if we want to actually have some kind of clear rules of the road, I think we need to start to clarify them, because I think if anything you can tell, we don't all know what they all look like and how they're all going to evolve. I will say this, that you know, one of the things that is hard for everyone, including myself, as I mentioned, is thinking about what all my needs are going to be for the next 10, 20, 30 years. And so as we sort of invest in these devices and things, I think that's the other piece of it, right, is I need to make a little cost-benefit calculus. And so it's not just the information about like what my rights are, but like really helping to kind of signal like what are the kind of rules and restrictions as I want to resell something, as I want to repair something, as I want to share it or loan it to a friend, those kinds of things. And I really feel like that information is only part of the issue. Me addressing whether copyright law is adequately providing consumers and companies with all the choices and competition and innovation that they need to make those things capable, I don't think we have an answer for that yet.
I thought Steven said something interesting. He said, you know, if there's an opportunity for more money to be made, then people will shift to a business model to maximize their profit. In the music space, we actually can't really do that because we're, again, saddled under decades of laws and regulations that suppress our ability to get real value for our work. So going back to the original question of erosion of ownership, again, it comes back to me. The ownership, and again, I will say property rights of the creators of music, that's where I think the rebalancing in copyright law needs to take place. There's legislation that's been offered, and I think hopefully there's an opportunity in the next Congress to look at some of these music licensing laws and modernize them, which again go back in different instances either to the 8-track era or pre-World War II or the piano player era. It's an area of the law that is in need of updating to reflect the digital marketplace.
So Jason mentioned that we're soon going to be in a world where, you know, almost every device is going to have software in it, and that software typically is going to have a technological protection on it. And so what that means is that anytime we're going to want to repair a device, modify a device, add on to the device, almost any device, we're going to have to go to the Copyright Office to get an exemption. So what we have, the way 1201 was worded, and the way it's been interpreted by some, not all courts, it in essence allows the Copyright Office to regulate virtually the entire economy. Now that is, again, that's not the free market, okay? And just the notion that every 3 years you'll be able to go to the Copyright Office and maybe get an exemption. You know, do we really want the Copyright Office making decisions about tractors, thermostats, automobiles, boats, airplanes, everything, okay? Because everything has software. And that's, I think, you know, as we're going forward, that's the question. Does it really make sense to have that level of regulation and that degree of control by one government agency, which clearly does not have any expertise in all of this, you know, across the range of the U.S. economy?
So I don't think we want the Copyright Office making those decisions. I don't think the Copyright Office wants to make those decisions either, right? So Jason and I wrote a book. It's for sale today. We have it here for you in hard copy for reasons that I think should be obvious to all of you now. I would recommend you purchase the hard copy version of the book. If not, you can get the book from the Amazon Kindle store.
I'm still surprised no one has a Kindle here and hasn't waved it up yet.
Will you autograph?
I really wanted that.
If forced to. Interestingly, you cannot buy our book from Apple, at least not right now. Apple rejected our book from the iBook store on the grounds that we used their trademark term iBooks in a way that they did not appreciate, which happened to be in three sentences of the book where we were critical of Apple. Now, I think it is problematic, and there is a point other than just sort of pure crass salesmanship here. There is something troubling, right, about a market where we give such incredible editorial control to one of a small handful of digital retailers, right? Any bookstore that doesn't want to carry our book doesn't have to carry our book, and that's certainly within their discretion to make that decision. I worry about a market where Apple's control over hardware and software and digital distribution gives it the power to deny millions of its customers the right to buy a book because they don't like the way we use a couple of words, right? So I think that ties back in to the broad themes that we've been talking about today. Why does ownership matter? I mean, Jason talked about a number of concrete reasons that we might care about ownership. The big picture reason is autonomy, right? The big picture reason is that we as individuals, that we as consumers operating not only in a marketplace, but operating in a democracy, need to have the ability to make decisions about how we use the products that we buy, about what we do with them, about whether we keep them or whether we sell them. And you know, that's the beauty of these personal property rights that we have tried to advocate for, right? Property means not having to ask permission. If I want to fix my tractor, I'll fix my tractor, right? If I want to use my device to download a book, it doesn't matter if Apple likes the book or not, right? And I think that's a really crucial thing to keep in mind going forward.
So lots of really big, fascinating, and sometimes scary stuff put on the table today. Privacy issues. I mean, I don't know if this is true, but it would seem to me that platforms that sell products might be able to track when you're using them and how you're using them. Just, you know, I don't know if consumers know that the customer loyalty card they use at as a brick and mortar retailer is recording their purchases for marketing data, or that some hotels with key cards know when you're in your room and when you're not because you're using an electronic key card. And I'm also disturbed about, you know, online platforms that have a huge percentage of the market and that use that to do things that are questionable, whether it's privacy or otherwise, even censorship. And to be candid, and I've seen online platforms that are willing to stop certain types of activity that are illegal and unsavory, but not, say, do so much about copyright infringement, which is a little disconcerting to me. So I think as we think about these, we need to realize how global they are and resist the temptation of those who obviously are looking for reasons to weaken copyright law and draw that there's a one-for-one conclusion between Tesla and copyright law. Are there interactions between copyright law and day-to-day products that didn't exist 100 years ago? Absolutely. Actually, this whole issue of embedded software is being studied by the Copyright Office right now at the request of Congress. We'll see what they come up with. But again, coming back to first principles, I see copyright law as protecting those who invest their talent, time, and money to create something, to create a new product, to protect them from unfair competition. We can debate about the exact scope of it, and we sure do. And if there's a way to write that law that avoids anti-competitive and completely unrelated uses of it that doesn't strike at the heart of the law, I'm happy to have that conversation too, but that's yet to be put forward. So, more to come.
All right, thank you for coming. We appreciate it.